Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to thank the organizers of this workshop for inviting me to be here, in particular WWF and Stefan Luter. It is a great pleasure to be here, and the first thought that I want to share with you is that in this equation between deep sea mining interests vs hydrothermal vent, unfortunately I fear that the environment has two reasons for concern. In Portugal, we went through two phases. The first phase was the euphoria of protecting our hydrothermal vent fields. Following good work done by WWF trying to protect, namely, our rainbow hydrothermal field, the task mission for the extension of the continental shelf, together with the Department on Oceanography and Fisheries of the University of Azores, start a very good job that ended in the protection of these windows to the evolution of life, the hydrothermal vent fields. The legal framework for this protection was OSPAR Convention, Annex 5, the European Union Directive Habitats, and also national provisions that were adopted to give ground to these international duties. So here we have, I will try to use these, let's see if it works, yes. In the Mid-Atlantic Ridge that is included in the Azores region, we have in all these areas several hydrothermal vent fields. So you can see this is the line of the EEZ in Azores, and this is the line of the extended continental shelf as proposed near the Commission on the Limits of the Continental Shelf. So what he did so far? Manege Guem, Lucky Strike, and Rainbow are named as OSPAR MPAs, so included in the network of OSPAR. Lucky Strike and Manege Guem here are also considered sites of community importance, this in 2009. Also, Rainbow was proposed to be included in the sites of community importance, so is included in the national list of sites in Portugal, but not yet included in the list. And all these three are classified under the national law as marine natural reserves. So in this phase of protecting, as Stefan showed before, there is a ban of fishing nets that contact with the bottom. And so all this area, including the rainbow hydrothermal field, are protected under these European Union regulation, even though the fishing nets don't go so deep. But under the precautionary principle, this decision was made. So in this context, the regional legislative decree that creates the Azores Marine Park inside the MPAs prohibits, it's an absolute prohibition of exploitation of mineral resources regarding exploration of mineral resources. If the exploration is using invasive techniques, this should be authorized and subject to prior binding opinion of the director of the park. So, but now we have a second phase, because together with these windows for the evolution of life, it comes also mineral resources that are very rich, as already showed before. And so, in 2012, Nautilus Mineral requested to the Portuguese Republic the concession of rights for exploration and exploitation of mineral deposits in that exact area that I showed before. This need to be interpreted together with some provisions of the Law of the Sea Convention, Article 2046. Should be considered in this case, but let's go ahead. So you can see these are the areas that Nautilus are requesting. And in all these areas there are several hydrothermal vent fields. The main important ones are included in that marine protected areas that was in the slide before, but several hydrothermal vent fields are not subject to any protection at the present moment. Here you can see better that you have the Manegwen MPA, the Lucky Strike MPA, and here you see the Little Rainbow MPA in the outer continental shelf, this one, and you see also the areas for exploration requested by Nautilus company, I mean. So this is what Nautilus request. I don't know if this is what the Portuguese government will approve. And because there are matters for concern. First, as I said, these areas include several hydrothermal vents. They are also very close to MPAs of the Marine Park of Azores. Actually, Rainbow is completely or nearly involved by the request for exploration. The areas for concession are clearly larger than the MPAs, and all these raise questions of representativeness of the habitats, about problems about connectivity between MPAs, what in this case calls the application of Habitats Directive, in particular Article 6, as interpreted by the European Court of Justice. I mean, there is a quite recent case law that argues that also in the areas that are not yet included in the list of sites of community importance, if there are there habitats that should be protected under the Habitats Directive, member states should take precautionary measures in order to avoid the damage of the ecological balance of the area. There is very interesting case law about this. I invite you to go deeper on this research. So, in the context of Portugal legislation, what do we have to make a fair balance between the purpose of exploration, but also the goal of protecting the hydrothermal vent fields. So we have a very old legislation that is in force at this moment, and it comes from the 90s, and it's very vague and insufficient regarding the environmental protection, I have to say. More recently, the Azores Regional Region approved a more environmentally friendly regulation on the access to geological resources. Actually, this regional decree foresees the application of the environmental impact assessment regime, requires a plan for the prevention of marine pollution, requires the respect of rules and recommendations adopted under Annex 5 of OSPAR Convention. And I have to say also the environmental impact assessment regime includes effective public participation in the evaluation, in the assessment process, and it's applicable to deep sea mining. But recently, very recently, this regional legislative decree was declared unconstitutional just because there is not the legal framework between the competences of the Azores regional government and the Portuguese Republic government. The regime is not very clear. And so we need to clarify who adopts the provisions applicable to the access to geological reserves. First, second, we need to clarify who will do the licensing. Third, who will do the environmental impact assessment. And as this framework is not very clear at this moment, Nautilus request was suspended. So now this is the time to think on this, because we still have time to propose a better solution for the environment. So the also in Portugal, we have legislation for the environmental impact assessment at a national level, but this legislation does not include deep sea mining. So, I mean, this legislation relies on the regional legislation to deal with the environmental impact assessment of mining in the deep sea. Even more recently, we adopt a basic law on marine special planning, and I have hope on this legislation, I have to say. This legislation tries to create a more coherent and complete legal system, and several instruments should be adopted in the near future. And I believe that we can find here a window to a more clear system, a more clear legal system where all the interests will be considered. Of course, this basic law should also be read together with basic law of environmental law that, as always, repeats all the current common core and on environmental protection. So I have to say that we have all the tools for a fair balance, all the legal tools for a fair balance between mining interests and environmental protection interests. I do hope that we will succeed in finding this fair balance. Because what should I think of this scenario? And I'm going to finish. I hope I am respecting my 10 minutes. So, in Portugal, at present, there is no clear strategy about deep sea mining in Portugal. Nevertheless, the recent legal developments open a window to an eventual strategy, confirmed by the new National Strategy for the Sea, also a very recent document, also from 2014. From an international perspective, I believe that the emergence of a regional system of governance that seeks for the effective protection of the environment in the context of mining will help raise awareness on domestic level and, as Lorenzo said in a private conversation, and also create at an international level a large debate on this issue. In this context, the OSPAR Convention system can give an important contribution. Habitats Directive, together with all the instruments that Aurore showed before, in my opinion, should be more clear and effective on their application to the deep sea, because Habitats Directive were created mainly to protect terrestrial biodiversity and coastal biodiversity. And the process of implementation, the Habitats Directive in marine environment is very poor. It's based on guidelines for the establishment of Natura 2000 approved by, or adopted by the European Commission together with the Interpretation Manual of European Union Habitats, but both the guidelines and both the Interpretation Manual don't have binding force. Only the Council of Ministers and the European Parliament can effectively change the Habitats Directive Annex 1 to include all the habitats from the deep sea, from the deep seas, and also eventually consider hydrothermal vent fields, seamounts, and so on as priority habitats to be protected. At this moment, there is a huge lack in the European Union legislation about this. And finally, more consideration should be given to the precautionary principle applicable ex ante, and an effective system of monitoring and control of mining, as well as of enforcement of environmental provisions, should be put in place, I mean ex post, after the exploration or eventually the exploitation start. This is what I have to say. Portugal is involved in a project that Aurore mentioned before, the MIDAS project for managing impacts of deep sea resource exploitation. So IMAR of Azores is a partner. And thank you for your attention. This is a quote from Kant that I like very much, because in this quote you can find all the speech about the next generations. In the planet, we only have a right of visit.